of the 2008 final, which was won by Brazil, their first gold medal in 8 attempts in women's volleyball at the Olympic Games. And the United States of America, from 9 appearances at the Olympic Games, have never finished worse than 8th, but have never won the gold medal. 2 silvers and a bronze, but still no cigar for the Americans. Will they break the famine tonight? A number of delicious ironies surrounding this clash. The Americans here with the best record of any of the 24 teams, from the men and women's, the only team not to have dropped a match. 7 from 7. Brazil, 6 from 7. And you guessed it, the only team that has beaten Brazil here at the Olympic Games in 2012, the United States, who beat them in pool play 3-1. So these two teams that must know each other well now, met in that final 4 years ago, met in pool play here in London, and meeting again in the final. Brazil, with both of their teams in their respective finals, looking for that rare double in the volleyball at the Olympic Games. So full house here, close on 15,000 people here to watch this match between these two powerful, muscular teams. That's the only description I can think of to describe the way they play, and I'm sure that will be their approach tonight, both Brazil and the United States.
Well, it promises to be an absolute cracker. It'll be a packed house, 15,000 seats at Earls Court, and no doubt there'll be an empty one at all as everyone looks forward to this. And although it's a repeat of the 08 game, there's only a handful of players who are actually still around from that, and particularly for the USA team. Logan Tom is the only player who is likely to make a start tonight, who started in that game. And you can see the win-loss rate. United States with a clean sheet. And I think the fact that these two have played together already will have nothing to do with how this game is played, because it's a clean slate. It's start again. It's the one-off game where it's all or nothing. And so whatever's happened in the past, both coaches will be telling each team, that last game doesn't matter. It's all about what we do now. It's about how well we execute our game plan and how well we stick to that and how well we can stop the other team from operating.
Yes, clearly neither side really wants to think about what happened 4 or 5 or 6 days ago. They'll only be focusing on what's on the other side of the net. There is the Brazilian record, beaten 3-1 by the United States. That was the winning score, incidentally, 4 years ago when they beat the USA 3-1 in that final in Beijing 4 years ago. And Jose Gamaitis, their coach, and there's their squad.
Well, it should be. As far as Brazil are concerned, they'll look to Fabiana. She played in 2008. Sheila Teixeira, who's a mainstay now, was only a substitute and came on in the last set in 2008, but she'll be starting probably for this one. And it'll most likely be Danny Lin's setting, and Shayla, number 13, another player who played in that final and knows what it's like to win. Guimarães, though, who was there that time, knows he's got a different set of players, more or less, and it's a different set of circumstances where he's actually coming into this game as the underdog.
So here is the American squad, and here's this record, 7 from 7. And just look at the number of digits that appear in that right-hand column there. They've only dropped 2 sets from the entire tournament. 7 matches, dropped a set against Korea, and then one against Brazil in the match they won 3-1. And there's this highly talented, experienced, and big, powerful squad.
Number 2, Daniel Scott Arruda. Number 3, Taiba Hanif Park, were starters in 2008. And throughout this tournament, they've been bench players and have given way to Destiny Hooker and to Krista Harmoto. And that's likely to be the case again today. Lindsay Berg, who came on as a substitute in 2008, will start this one. She's the mainstay in the setting position. And we should expect to see Jordan Larson and Logan Tom through the outside.
There's the man who's trying to create or duplicate a wee piece of volleyball history here, to become only the second man, the second coach, to win a gold medal both in the men's division, which he did 4 years ago with the American men, and now trying to repeat that here with the women. So the Americans with the slightly better record, but Clayton, who's your favorite? Who do you think will win here?
If the USA play as they have played throughout this, then Brazil won't have an answer. Brazil's best hope is to get the middle running, to get Fabiana and Thaisa away, and then use Sheila to go through the gaps that the middle will start to open up as USA's middle starts to compete. But if the Brazilians don't get a hold of the USA serve, then I think we can see a repeat of the pool game. I certainly think it's going to be close in the sets, but I fancy it'll be a USA victory.
Thoughts there of former Great Britain international Clayton Lucas, and he's been pretty accurate with his predictions so far. Probably got a good future as a bookmaker if he ever decides to give this wonderful game away. But we'll see how he goes tonight, USA versus Brazil. Haven't seen a five-setter in any of the knockout matches so far. Possibility, I guess, we might see one tonight. Andrei Zinovich from Russia and Zorica Belic from Serbia, the two officials who will control this game. Now we await the starting lineups for the two teams.
So Brazil are going to come out first, and they'll start with the captain, Fabiana. She's going to go through the middle, and it's Dani Lins, number three, who'll be setting ahead of number nine, Fernandinha. It'll be number six, Taisa, who only came on in the last set in 2008 to play, but she's a starter here for this final. Number 13, Shayla, will be playing in the opposite slot as she did in 2008. And number 16, Fagare through the outside, and number eight, Jackie, makes up the other outside hitting position. And Fabi, who played in 2008, also in as the starting libero. It's the best team that Brazil can put out, without question.
Fabiana, Lins, Taisa, Jackie, Shayla, Fabi, and Fagare. The Brazilian time. Now here is the American team with their captain and setter, Lindsay Burke.
Well, Lindsay relishing the opportunity. She's captain for this one. She didn't start in 2008. She came on in the second set and then had to see her team win that set, but go on to ultimately to lose the match. Logan Tom gets to start. She's going through the outside. It's Jordan Larson, who wasn't even in the team in 2008, going through the outside, wearing number 10. Krista Harmoto, also another player who's come in since 2008, going through the middle. Number 16, Akin Rideu, and number 19, Destiny Hooker. Destiny Hooker in the opposite slot, Akin Rideu going through the middle, and it's Nicole Davis, number six, who plays as libero.
There's their lineup: Berg, Davis, Larson, Harmoto, Tom, Akin Rideu, and Hooker. Those last two players, incidentally, foreign-born. Akin Rideu, born in Canada, and Hooker, born in Germany. Now proud Americans and trying to win a gold medal for themselves and their country, something the American women, as I mentioned, have never done before. Top blocker at the tournament so far, Akin Rideu. And it looks as if it will be Jackie to start this gold medal match. The battle for the gold medal is underway, with the Brazil on the left in the yellow and the United States playing from right to left. Little mistake there from the Americans, giving the first point of the match to the Brazilians. Seemed a little indecisive with that hit over the net. That little dink that the Brazilians tried. And fairly easy point first up also from the Americans, gifted to them from the Brazilians. So now the American captain, Lindsay Berg. Picked up there by the Americans on the back row, still alive. They'll just give the free ball to Brazil, who will come through the middle. But there's some good defensive work here from the Americans early on, off the block and out.
Well, interesting start for both sides, really. No one getting full control of what's going on. A few nerves, understandably so, when they're on the biggest stage of their volleyball careers.
Yes, just poking that away from the two-man American block and into that vacant floor. Must have gone out, actually. Must have been too big. 3-1. Back with Berg. And Kinradeo and Hooker doing well off the block. The Americans have it controlled again. Berg. And yes.
Excellent play. The USA slowing down Brazil's offense, getting touches in the block, enabling them to recycle the ball, put it into what's called transition, and then come back and attack. Great lead for them. I think if they score another point here, we could see Brazil taking a timeout.
Service, of course, still with Berg. And yes, it is the fifth point for the Americans. And pretty sure that will be a timeout called by Jose Guimaras. 5-1, they mean business, the American women.
Guimaras just wants to settle things down. It's his team who are far more nervous than the USA at the moment. USA are just trying to pin Faye Garay, number 16. She's the front court swing hitter. They're making her pass the ball at the moment in between her and the libero, Fabiana, just to make it difficult for her, give her something extra to think about before she goes and gets herself in a position to try and attack the ball.
Yes, the Brazilians got a couple of really good spikes in those one or two of those early rallies, which the Americans handled, I thought, really well, composed, and managed to recycle the ball and ahead by 5-1. So Berg again serving. The Brazilians really keen to break this run here inside out if they can. And no, must have been too big again.
Well, she thought it had gone in, and it's a bit disconcerting because the lines judges start with their flag going in as if to say, yep, it's in, and then raise it up almost at very late in the day and giving a false hope to the team who've hit the ball.
Cool as a cucumber, Herb McCutcheon. So Berg finally has her service run ended, and Thaisa now. Brazilians, what can they do from their serve? They need some points. And a little tip, and off the block. Yes, just off the hands of the Brazilian blockers. There's another foreign influence in the American team there. Herb McCutcheon from New Zealand. Logan Tom. She was the top point scorer at the last Olympics, not so here. Going for the tip. This is a fine rally, this one. And the Americans trying again in the Brazilian block. Fabiana. In particular, there she is to the right. I'm sure she's the tallest player in the Brazilian team at 1.94 meters. Yes, 6'4". And look at that, she got it perfect. Shayla's service didn't last for long. And we will have first technical timeout with McCutcheon, I'm sure, very pleased with his charges so far. It's a nice little lead they've got. All the pressure on Brazil now for the rest of the set.
Well, they'll be chasing. They'll be trying at the same time just to settle themselves down and get into a rhythm. They haven't really had a solid period of play to put pressure on that. It's all been them on the back foot with them defending what the USA are throwing at them, because the USA have been picking the ball up and recycling it, and then Brazil have had to go with and chase with their block, and it's their block points which are doing better for them at the moment than their attacking points.
McCutcheon, a man of a few words during these timeouts. He's not one inclined to want to read the right act to his charges, even if things aren't going as well as he would like. Just a few succinct words of encouragement. And then one, two, three, and off they go. So Brazil need a side out here. Look in the devil. And haven't got it yet. Tom with the little dink, but no joy. Fabiano at the net. Well, no, the point was from the Americans, 9-3.
Just some niggly little errors creeping in for Brazil. Net touches and the ball going out. Again, they're trying to pin Figueiredo. They're serving over to that far side where the players for Brazil are stacked at the moment. Danny Lins, Fabiano and Figueiredo.
That's better from Brazil. Once they get that attack working, they become a very different team. Coming through the middle there and finishing it off. 9-4. But that's the two spikes so far for Brazil. And Fernanda. Destiné Hooker, who is the top spiker here at this tournament. It's done on a percentage, an efficiency percentage. And look at that. Not a bad serve either. When you're up by 10-4, just floated into literally no man's land there. No one wanted it.
So straight between two players. Figueiredo should have played that. She thinks it's going out and she's left it, but it's comfortably in. That's a poor decision from Figueiredo.
This is surprising that there is this separation between these two teams so early in the first set. Off the American block, so much needed point there for Brazil. Or maybe they are just overcome with the nerves and they're going to take the best part of it, a set to settle down. Fabiana, the captain.
She served down to position one with her first serve last time out. And it was easily sided out.
Americans looking for the side out here, and they get it. And that's really, I guess, Clayton, all they need to do from now on, don't they? Just make sure they nail those side outs.
Well, I'm amazed at the way Shayla's playing at the moment. For someone who already has an Olympic gold medal, played in 2008, the court is wide open for her, and she's come up with an unforced error. She's not got herself into this game at the moment. I think they've made more unforced errors in this set than we've seen them make in most matches.
Yeah, they just haven't been able to get that attack working, have they? I guess if they just get a few points off their own serve, it would help settle them down, get them into their rhythm.
And you can tell, Guimar, as you're saying, these are basic errors that they're making. He's saying to Thaisa, I'm pretty sure he's saying, if that ball's past line, I want you to hit line. I don't want you to go across where you've gone. And it opened up for her anyway. She had to go over Logan Tom with that last play. USA were dragged right across to the right, and there was acres of space to go back down. And the way she was coming in and hit the way she was facing cross court, and she hit across her body.
Yes, you didn't have to be fluent in Portuguese to understand that he was very annoyed with some of the basic mistakes they're making, gifting points to the Americans. And there's one back for Brazil from the American serve. 13-6, and Thaisa getting a right dressing down from the coach there. Now their setter, Danny Leans. And also the thing Brazil have done here, they've just given America a huge lift to their esteem and confidence with the way they're racing through this first set.
Great slide, and Harmoto just waited until she's able to drift past Jackie to find the line.
Costa Harmoto. Seems to be a bit of indecision, doesn't there, around these attacks of Brazil.
There's a lack of aggression, certainly, I think, from Shayla at the moment, who is a lead point scorer for her team. That was unlucky, that one landing right in between three players for the USA.
Here was Jackie with the serve.
Huge block. Lindsay Berg as well, she'll love that. The lining up Akin Ridewo, and I'm pretty sure Lindsay got a hand on the ball. Oh, it's all Lindsay. She's put down Faye Garay. Psychologically, that's a huge block and a huge confidence booster for Berg against Faye Garay.
Yeah, she's only 1.73 meters. The American setter and captain going for the tip, but easily taken care of by the Americans, and more of these basic unforced errors here. And we're at our second technical timeout. We've had 13 minutes of the match, and America at 16-7.
Well, just looking at the way the two teams are serving in this first set, and it's very clear that Brazil at the moment, they've only had eight serves. They haven't been able to get a run of serves, and the serves have been very easy. They've been mid-court, and the passing unit have been put under no pressure at all at the moment. They've dropped one ball short inside the three-meter line, and the rest have just been straightforward onto the serve-receive unit. Interesting, a little quick red. Not quite sure what he means by that. He does have his own language, does Hugh McCutcheon at times, even though he's speaking English. But they all know what it means, and that's the important thing. He has got his team serving extremely well. They are pinning the front court swing hitter, and the court, for those of you maybe slightly new to the game, it's broken down into six zones. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six being bottom right as we look at the net now, two being top right, and then we go around anti-clockwise. And so they are serving. Lindsay Berg has been chief server. He's going to serve straight down at Faye Garay where she is, because she's the front court swing hitter, and they're getting some joy with that serve.
Sohuka again. Too big again. Just is not working here for Brazil at all. 17-7. And this is just a nightmare, isn't it, for Brazil, this first set. Everything they do. And the Americans just protecting the floor superbly, aren't they? Nothing getting past them at the moment.
And that's forcing Brazil into going harder and chasing after it. They're getting tighter, snatching at it, and we're seeing these errors, Shayla in particular. I'm just wondering who, if anybody, he could bring in for Shayla in the opposite slot. Maybe Tandara or Natalia.
And another error at the net there.
Well, this set is over now. It's gone. Mm. There's no way Brazil are taking this one from this position. Well, that's interesting. So Faye Garay gets the hook, even though she's having a pretty good game, actually. She's not done anything wrong. But sometimes, as a coach, you need to make a change just to try and change the dynamic of what's going on. Even though Faye Garay's done nothing wrong, and we can see that Shayla's having a bit of a shocker, it's Faye Garay who's got the hook. It's all gone terribly wrong for Guimaraes now. The substitutes come on and just been stonewall roofed by Destiny Hooker. In fact, Akin Ridewo getting across and closing the gap.
And the Americans probably looking at the scoreboard and finding it hard to believe. 19 points to 7. The whistle had gone. Must have been, yes, double contact there. It's only the third error that the United States have made, third scoring error that they've made in the set.
So Larson tried to get herself set, but was almost there. Hadn't got a still moment to then set through the ball. And if it had been the set of Lindsay Berg, the referee would have probably let her get away with it. Now Adam Nazir's come in, a change for Brazil, having the serve, as they just try and find something. But the serving is just not tough enough at the moment against the USA. They are lapping it up. Paola's time on court's come to an end. I think Fegere is going to come back on there. That's two swings, two errors for Paola. She got blocked, she's hit out. And Grimaris has got little patience as it is.
And Paola, who was one of those survivors from 2008, started in that final 4 years ago. But that's fast becoming, I imagine, a distant memory for every Brazilian fan at the moment.
Well, it's quite incredible the number of unforced errors we're seeing at the net. And this is because, in part, Brazil scared of this huge block. Hooker and Akinwudeu and Fegere having to hit higher than she probably normally would. She's found a gap in the block, but because she's hitting higher than she normally would, the angles are all different and they're missing on the baseline because they're not getting the steep enough angle when they're actually attacking the ball.
Well, the Americans, I guess, throwing everything at Brazil now with its huge lead. The odd serve that might hit the net is probably neither here nor there in the wash-up of this set anyway. And it's just all-out attack. 22-9, and the substitutions being made thick and fast here by the Brazilian coach.
Well, it's a last-ditch attempt now. He's brought in Fernandinha to go across the back row. She'll be setting, and Tandara across the front as a blocker, just so they can have more attackers at the net and a little bit more height to stop what the USA are doing. At last, their first point from serve.
Up to three side outs here from the United States, and this set will be theirs. There's one of them.
What the USA have done very well in this set, Brendan, is they have released their front court hitters and gotten them in a position early, and that's enormous. Right over the top of Fegere, Destiny Hooker, to put that away. But she was under no pressure. She was out wide waiting for that ball to be set to her because Nicole Davis had taken the pass. And the USA are doing that really well. It's doing the same for Jordan Larson when she's front court. The back court pass is taking the ball and allowing then the USA to become a really quick point of attack wide.
Their retrieving has been outstanding from the Americans in the set. And Brazil finding it really difficult to get through there. And even when they do,
well, I think
America still win the point. So set point.
And the referee must be thinking, this is deja vu. Every time Brazil spike, he's giving the ball out and to the USA. Unbelievable number of unforced errors.
And Rodeo serving for the first set. That's better from the Brazilians. A powerful spike there from Tandara. And got a good swing on the ball. Watch this.
At last, he managed to split the block, and she's got one-on-one and been able to have put some pressure on the USA.
What they're playing for here now is a bit of self-confidence that they can take something into this a second set. A few points off their serve would certainly help them, that's for sure. And there it is, off the block, 25-11. In just 22 minutes, the United States have grabbed control of this final. They're not home yet by any stretch of the imagination. And Brazil will just have to try and put this behind them. A rogue set, certainly not indicative of the way they've played here in London over the last 2 weeks. And they've just got to find their natural game and start again. And look at those stats there. Just five spikes from 34 from Brazil, which tells you about the performance of the American blockers. And, well, the service errors, if anything, well, they do favour the Brazilians, only one opposed to the three from America. And the glum look on the faces of those Brazilian fans tells you that they know their team is in big trouble here.
One thing that stat doesn't tell you is the number of unforced errors Brazil made, which we were able to see from their spiking, the fact they missed the court. And just looking down quickly at the results that the USA have had, that is their best set win in the tournament so far. To beat someone to 11.
Well, the Americans' 25 points, 9 of them came from errors committed by Brazil, and in turn, the United States only conceded 4 unforced error points to Brazil.
Well, Brazil must come out, have to do better. They've got nothing to lose now. They can't play any worse than that, surely not, when they come out for this second set. And they really do need to play and show us just exactly why they've made it through to this final and how good they are. They had that one blip. They got soundly beaten by Korea 3-0. In a game where they didn't get started, but that was a different sort of set of circumstances where things just weren't quite going right for them. Whereas tonight, in this game, in that first set, absolutely nothing went right for them.
Yes, by far and away, the chief contributor there to the United States score was opposition errors, 9, and Hooker contributed most in terms of actual points, 5, 4 from Akinradeo, and 2 from Larson and 1 from Berg.
I don't think Christo Harmato actually had a swing. Akinradeo had a swing through the middle, and Harmato was pretty much an innocent bystander throughout that game.
Well, the bald facts are that these two teams have now played 5 sets of volleyball at this Olympic Games, and America have won 4 of them. But from Brazil's point of view, they've just got to bury that first set, consign it to history, and this is where the match starts afresh. They win 3 sets. From this point on, they take the gold medal home. First thing they need is a good, solid set, and they have found that. Start the way you intend to finish.
Nice spike by Jackie. She's probably the one solid player in the team. She's just never had a ball to swing on in that first set.
Two points in a row. That is cause for celebration here for Brazil. Hard to believe that they could be as inept in this set as they were in the first. Hooker. And off the block. 3 straight points here for Brazil.
It was almost inconceivable that they would come out and play their way they did in that first set. And it's amazing what confidence does. Buoyed up, 2 great spikes from Jackie, and then Fegere coming in with that one off the block.
And finally, United States through Logan Tom are able to break that run. Get their first point of the second set.
Tom has an interesting jump serve. She kind of skips out towards her left and then comes back in to deliver the spike.
And a free ball there for Brazil. So another opportunity to get some points on the board. The Americans again doing this very good job of protecting the floor. Yes, they've got the orange paint covered tonight and just letting that ball drift out of bounds.
Well, the longer the rallies go on, the harder it gets. Wonderful dig from Logan Tom. Good read by Fabi to keep the ball in play. And eventually, it's the power of Hooker that takes the ball out over the baseline. Well covered by Nicole Davis.
Tom again with the serve for the United States. And Rodeo puts it high. So just have to sail over and could be out again, yes.
Well, it's just a miscommunication between Fabi and Jackie. They both wanted to play the ball. Fabi had made a wonderful dig partway through that rally. High hands defense from her, like a goalkeeper, keeping it out of the back of the net. And then Jackie makes the touch. But they just didn't talk to each other, put too much on it. And a good call from Logan Tom to let Nicole Davis, it was out. I think we got a good insight actually into Hugh McCutcheon at the start of that second set. 3-0 down, and Brazil jumping all over the place. Could quite easily have called a timeout, but he didn't. He let it ride, and his team are now right back in this second set, just a point behind. Well, that was nearly an embarrassing moment then for Brazil. They weren't expecting Destiny Hooker to come up and get her hands across the net like that on the overpass. She just comes in and just almost jumps straight over the, in fact, Akin Rodeo just jumps over Lindsay Berg, and it nearly landed in.
McCutcheon, what does he do now? 6-3.
Well, that's first big unforced error from Destiny Hooker, and now is his time to call the timeout.
The pragmatic philosopher, right? Ebb and flow.
We couldn't be more right. It's exactly what happens. And we've sat and we've watched all the matches that have taken place during this Olympic Games. And we've seen every single time a team goes up, a team comes back. A team then who's come back goes up, the other team comes back. He knows the way it flows, the way the game's going to roll. And he's happy with that. He knows and what his team can do. They've showed that in the first set. And he's quite happy for it to be like it is at the moment up till the next technical timeout and to 16, and then they'll look to make a move as they reach the 25 mark.
Yeah, well, they couldn't get the side out, which is what he wanted, and they usually deliver when he finishes with that little request. 7-3. Now, can Brazil sustain this level for the remainder of the second set? Well, there is the side out for America at 7-4.
That was an enormous block from Akin Rodeo. She's gone right across the net to take away the space, and it almost came back down under the net. She was so far across. Well, the blocking's very solid for the USA. I was a little bit surprised in that rally when Nakamudo and Larson went back inside to come out again, because there was only one place it could go. Fegere chasing after the ball, and she just opened up the angle cross court.
Good thinking at the net there from Brazil. Just a little tip, caught the Americans napping a little, and that is the first technical timeout. And Brazil have turned things around to some degree anyway. 3 points ahead at 8-5. And Jose has calmed right down.
One thing we saw, those of you that watched the semi-final game when Brazil played Japan, was you would have noticed that Taiza was coming in through the middle right in front of Danny Lins and pounding the ball away. And then Fabiana was going on the slide behind, drifting out past Danny Lins to the aerial to deliver the spikes. First time we've seen Fabiana be able to do that in this match. It's a set and a half almost over, and the first slide behind we've seen from Brazil. And Thaisa's been up and had one that she's hit out. Middle's not being allowed to operate at the moment, but as soon as it does, as soon as Fabiana can do that, then USA could be in trouble.
Yes, that's what we saw a lot of from Fabiana in their match against Japan, and particularly in that match against Russia as well. But not seeing so much of it tonight yet. America pull another one back at 8-6. Who plays her club volleyball, I think, in Brazil, didn't she? So she's probably very familiar with all of these players, or some of them anyway. And a nice block. Fabiana, the captain, trying to lift her team here, inspire her teammates.
Logan Tom just getting a little bit ahead of herself. The ball was slightly in front. She was chasing after it. She lost some height and tried to go with a comfortable hit cross court, but was closed down very well by Fabiana.
Figueiredo to serve for Brazil. Yeah, this is a lot better stuff from Brazil in this set, isn't it? They've found their rhythm, they've got their timing, and they're looking a lot more settled within themselves as well.
That going in the seam of the block, the gap between the two blockers. One thing Brazil are doing, enabling them to have this opportunity, is the fact that they're passing better. And I'm sure Hugh McCutcheon will have a chat with Hamato about her blocking. He talked to her in the last semi-final match about not spread blocking. He wants her to go straight across the net. He wants her, if she's going to seal the gap, to actually reach across both hands.
Bird comes in for the set, looking for the little tip there, but pretty obvious, and sets it up nicely, unfortunately for the Americans, for the Brazilians. And look at this, a 5-point lead now. This is significant.
Only one blocker up against Faye Gray on the backcourt pipe, and you just have too many angles left and right. There's too much space to try and stop with one blocker. Guimarães now a happy coach.
USA, hey, listen, ebb and flow, I know, but we got to outwork a little bit here. Right now we're getting outplayed, but we shouldn't be getting outworked. So we got to side out right now, and then we got to start building, and it starts with discipline. Don't try and do too much, just try and make a good play, and another good play, and another good play, and we'll see what happens from there. Here we go. Start with a side. 1, 2, 3. Good
game. I think that's probably the longest speech he's made.
Mm. And even then, he's not complicating things, is it? He's not throwing 100 different ideas at them in 30 seconds, telling them all the things they're doing wrong. Play by play, one rally at a time. And Figueiredo.
You can see how both teams match up pretty well. They're all capable, the three power hitters, the two outside hitters and the opposite player, all capable of hitting the backcourt pipe and all being used to do that on both sides. And then good height in the middle for both sets of teams. And it's just a question of the setters, really, in orchestrating that and who's going to organise it better.
Out of bounds. 11-8. Berg with a little reverse set, and in comes Motto, gets in behind and swings it away, and the word of Herb starting to come true here. Ebb and flows, and the Americans have absorbed the ebb and now they're starting to flow, and that prompts a timeout from Brazil.
I quite like the fact that he said, you know, okay, we're getting outplayed, but let's not get outworked. Let's work hard, make them earn their points. And that's what they've done now. Great swing from Destiny Hooker on the backcourt pipe. And then also with Hamato coming on that slide behind. Hamato and Akinridewu, both of them can go on the slide behind, but both of them also like to hit the short ball in front. It's not a definite division of labor between the two of them like we see with Brazil. And Thaisa only going in front and Fabiana only going behind. So it does pose a few more questions for Brazil when USA get their middle running as to where it's going to go.
Hamato again, continuing to serve a course for the United States, but side out to Brazil. Fabiana getting in more of those swings in this set than she was able to in the first. And that's one of the reasons why the women in yellow are ahead by three.
Was very tentative from Thaisa. Thaisa's one of the tallest players in world volleyball outside of Gamova, and she's let Lindsay Berg, one of the shortest players on the side of the USA, wipe off her hands and out. Instead of standing there with her hands up already and saying, no, you're not doing that, she actually kept them down and then went up very tentatively late in the day. Well, Shayla still struggling in this match. One-on-one, you'd expected her to put it away. Great block from Logan Tom, can't take anything away from that, but it's just not Shayla's match at the moment. She doesn't look comfortable.
Well, she's been the top point scorer for Brazil at the tournament with 106, but off her game tonight, and that's affecting the Brazilians and the Americans. Back on equal footing with Brazil. They've clawed their way back, play by play, in the words of Herb. And great battle going on here also between the fans, isn't there? There's a large contingent of Americans, in most cases you'd be outsung and outdroned by Brazilian fans at any sporting event, but fantastic atmosphere here prevailing at Earls Court in this capacity crowd, watching this endlessly fascinating struggle going on here. Talk about ebb and flows. Certainly good for their two-point lead, aren't they, Brazil, in this set at the moment?
Well, they've let USA come back at them, but they've just broken away again, and this is much better from Shayla. Over the top, right into the corner. Fantastic shot. Back to her best with that one.
Just her third point of the night to Shayla, the top Brazilian point scorer from the tournament. In
Oh, that was some rally, that really was. It looked as if USA had control of it. Wonderful dig from Destiny Hooker, but in the end, it was that tip. And Nicole Davis had seen the hand go up, thought it was going to be tip short, went running in, and then gets caught wanting. You never know where it's going to go. You have to wait until it's been played, especially in the tip situation. Had she stayed where she was, she'd have dug it quite easily.
But you see the read, you react to your instinct, and sometimes you don't get it right. Wow, the Brazilians absolutely flowing here at the moment, and America is back in ebb. Technical timeout, 16-12.
I think that one was because he knew the world was watching and listening, calling it slot, but he's right. It's a chance ball, and I don't think, and a lot of teams, a lot of players always think hand up, tip short, but it's a chance ball. And if you get that in your head that it's a chance ball and that anything can happen, but you know you're not going to get the ball hit hard at you, you go into a tennis-style defense, like you're waiting to receive serve from in tennis, which means you can then move and go and chase it down or hold your position for a ball that's going to be tipped right onto you. And that's the mindset you need to have. And he's quite right. He said, don't get all muscled up on the big bang, i.e. the big, powerful spikes, and then when the ball's being rolled and whatever else, we're not able to deal with it.
Through the middle, but too big. 17-12, and Brazil now absolutely in control of the second set here. We've had that second technical timeout. They've got a 5-point lead. They know. Just take care of the side outs here, and they will be back in this match. So Megan Hodge comes on for Jordan Larson. First appearance in the match. This is almost a remarkable transformation, isn't it, Clayton? I mean, considering how comprehensively outplayed they were in the first set, you might have thought it would take them a couple of sets to kind of really get back into their rhythm, but they've just hit the ground running literally since the start of the second set. They have buried the memory of that first set, and right now they are storming to the second set to tie this match up.
It was a case of rabbits in headlights in the first set for Brazil, but they've come right back out fighting in the second one.
Nice little touch there right over the top from McEnroe-Deo. Be very hard for the Americans, you'd think, to win the set from here, given the way and the confidence with which Brazil are playing now. There's their captain, Fabiano.
First swing for Taiza, first big important swing in the set. She goes up quick in the middle. It just helps to ease Brazil even further away.
Jackie, the top point scorer for Brazil in the match so far. There's Logan Tom. Gets one back for the Americans, but to 14-19. And she has a quick look at the scoreboard, doesn't want to dwell on that, I imagine. And chance here for Brazil to side out. Just have to return the ball with the third hit, which gives Brazil the opportunity to get the big swing in, which they do.
Good play from Danny Lins, deciding to go to Taiza in transition. USA at full stretch, good dig from Tom, but then hoisted high in the free ball and four attacking opportunities. Lins does the right thing, straight into the middle. Megan Hodges, new into the game, not helping out Akinri Dayewu to stop Taissa.
And here is Taissa at the serving line. Hodge, the new player on the court there. That's nice swing again there from the United States. From 20 to 15 from Logan Tom. And that spike count evened up considerably here as a result of the second set. Now the Americans, if they've got any chance here, need to win rallies like this off their own serve. And the Brazilians will be well aware of that. A nice block at the net there. And again, finding room through that back row. Shayla starting to find the form that has made her one of the stars of this tournament. 21 to 15. Remember, the United States, this is their eighth match here, and they've only dropped two sets in 15 days. They might be about to drop another one here.
Well, the introduction of Hodge hasn't really helped the USA. A couple of faltering passes. And not a good block from the USA either. A little bit too far, drifted past Fagaray. She had an unopposed swing straight through into the heart of USA's defense.
And another average kind of reception there from Hodge, but it was recovered. But United States always on the back foot after that serve. 23 to 15, closing out this set almost as impressively as the Americans won the first, 25-11. Tom chasing that ball, but Fabiana, meat and drink for her.
That's surprising. Shayla opting for that serve. Megan Hodge under enormous amount of pressure, number 11 for the USA. A standard float serve straight at her would have caused just as much problems as trying to go with a one-foot float.
Set point has arrived for the Brazilians. Boy, what an interesting match this has become now. Where does it go from here? What's the next chapter?
Well, first and foremost, the Brazilians going with the double substitution to put Fernandinha in the back row, the setter, and Tandara into the front row. So some height, blocking height at the net. And then if they get it into transition, they've got three attacking opportunities front court, plus Shayla available on the back court pipe.
There's one for the Americans, but 24-17, that's the really fascinating aspect of this match so far has been how decisive each set has been in favour of one team or the other. That if they'd been two very close sets, you would have thought, well, yeah, that's the nature of the match and these two teams, point by point, side out by side out, but America completely dominated the first, and Brazil on top here, now trying to finish this set off. And that's exactly what they've done, 25 to 17, with Fabiana again, the captain, getting her eighth point of the match so far. And in just 25 minutes, not much longer than it took the Americans to dispose of them in that opening set, Brazil are right back on equal terms with the United States. And I'm sure the memories of that first set are well and truly gone. 25-11, 25-17 in the two scores. And let's have a look at some of these stats from the second set, which will make a lot healthier reading than they did the first for Brazil. And look at the spike difference there, 20 for Brazil but just 12, way below the 50%, which tends to be somewhere like a good pass mark. The Americans well below that at 12 from 30. Samba time up there in the bleachers of Earl's Court. And the dismal reaction to the end of the first set. Gone, and some joy and excitement and smiles back on the faces of these Brazilian women as they know they're right in this match. They're back in the hunt for the gold medal. There's Fabiana, this inspirational captain, and there's Fagara as well. And Megan Hodge resigned to the fact that this wasn't going to be their set. So that's a fairly rare experience for the Americans. Only the third time, as I said, in just over 2 weeks in eight matches that they've dropped a set. The only unbeaten team here in the volleyball, men and women, 24 teams, and the only one up until now who haven't tasted defeat in any match, 7 from 7 prior to the start of this, and it looked as if it was probably going to be 8 from 8 after the end of that first set, but the Brazilians have got other ideas. They are the defending champions.
Well, very interestingly, I think what Brazil were able to do in that second set was stop the USA from operating at the high level that they were operating at in the first set. Their serving was much better. They put more pressure on the USA, and then they were able, as a result, Brazil, to get more blockers out and put up better defense against USA's attack. And as a result, they did to the USA what the USA did to them. They got hands on the ball, slowed it down, put it into transition, recycled it, however you want to call it, and then gave them an opportunity to attack the ball. And Shayla then started to get engaged. Thaisa was then able to get engaged, and so too was Fabiana on the slide behind. A much better performance from Brazil. And if the USA didn't know they were in a match, well, they surely do now.
The Brazilian setter to start this third set. What will unfold here? And first points, and first psychological point as well there to Brazil.
I think Jackie knew she had to put that one away. The initial roll shot that was going out, Guimarães, the coach, was screaming it was going out, but she played it, and she more than made up for that when she came back and hit the ball through the outside. Just incredible. Overpassed by the USA. Thaisa waiting. Doesn't get any easier than that as a middle blocker waiting. Don't have to go up and put a block up. She gets a free swing and a brilliant start for Brazil.
This match following not at a similar path to the one 4 years ago, where each country won a set. I think it was one all after two sets. The role was slightly reversed. Brazil won the first set, United States won the second, and Brazil won the third set easily, 25-13, 4 years ago between these two teams in that gold medal match. And leading quite comfortably at the moment, early in this third set here, 3-1. Yes, we can only surmise, but they must just have been shell-shocked by the whole occasion there at the start of this match, which accounted for their poor performance, going down 11-25 in that first set.
Maki Rideau with a smile on her face, and that's because she made a complete mishit of the ball, put some backspin on it, but got away with it.
A Canadian-born American at the serving line. I think that's out. Yes. 4-2. I don't think the Americans were ahead at any stage, were they, of that second set. So they, last time they've been in front in this match was at the end of the first set. Did it touch a finger? Well, yes. It left hand, the one with the, the plaster hand there of Paula, was it? Shayla. Great work from Brazil. They looked dead a couple of times in that rally, didn't they? But they just persevered, and in the end, Fagare.
Super block right across the net, and then it was off Fagare and into Fabiana to go down. This is just a complete turnaround. I'm not sure the USA know quite how to deal with it at the moment. They're going to let this serve happen. I don't think, if they don't side this out, then Hugh McCutcheon will be considering a timeout and free ball for Brazil.
And as usually happens, the point follows as well. 6-2. Well, he does get a technical timeout, but no, he can't wait until the score gets to 8. He wants to talk to his charges right now.
Feeling that, having seen the way this one is now going, let's hope it's not a case of magic ends and the team on the far side keeps winning the points. But USA need to find something pretty quickly now, or this set's going to run away from them. We could end up going to a fifth, and Brazil just letting them off the hook with that serve.
Well, rather like their football players, they are so emotional, aren't they, that when they get on a high, and it just comes so naturally to them, don't they? And I think this is what we're seeing. They're just in such instinctive players. And a very high free ball for the United States. And there's another overpass. It's two that Brazil have been able to defend and turn back, but this time the United States. And this is what they need. They need just a little few more of these inspirational players to help lift them, get them back into the game.
Well, Hugh McCutcheon has made a change. Hodge is back in, Larson's off, but that was a wonderful block from Harmotto. It was Hodge who had the overpass but couldn't put it away. We haven't seen much of Destiny Hooker. She's not had many clean winners at the moment in this third set.
No, she's been quite invisible, hasn't she? That's too big. You'd think sooner or later, Clayton, one of these sets is going to go right down to the wire, maybe beyond 25 between these two teams. They can't all just be clear-cut wins to one side or the other, these sets, and this might be the one.
That one's just gone off the block as it sailed out. USA weren't going to admit to it. Players never do admit to it. And it's up to the refs and the line judges to spot it. Just off of Megan Hodge and out of play. Excellent block. Fagare stood out wide waiting for that one. Harmotto was coming around and on to her instead of having to chase the ball particularly out for it and let the attacker get beyond her. So wonderful blocking, and I think the technical timeout couldn't have come soon enough.
This is Paulo Jr., the assistant coach of the Brazilian side, just with a few things to say, as well as Gomares.
Well, kind of typical USA setup. Uma Kachin has a chat with a few of them, and then Karch Kirai, the assistant coach, maybe he'll have a chat now and again with a couple of the players, but he's quite a quiet individual. And surprising, really, he's a three-time Olympic gold medalist.
Well, this is right, yeah. It does surprise me, given his CV, his status and stature in the game, particularly in the United States, observations throughout the fortnight here that he seems to play a fairly minor role once the match gets underway. Maybe he does a lot of the work and training and practice.
I think what we've seen, obviously, he was an outside hitter in his day, and that's evident in the way that Logan Tom and Jordan Larson play, and now with the libero in, it's a very, very strong passing and outside hitting unit, but at the moment it's not quite operating as to the level it has been throughout this tournament.
Off the block from the spike from Hodge. Fabiana, she's on her game now, isn't she? This is the Fabiana we saw against Russia and in the semi-final.
Harmoto is gambling on something that's just not going to happen. They are running Fabiana behind all the time. She needs to see that movement, and she needs to either try and outfake Dani Linz by making a move with her shoulder right and then moving left, because she's getting left behind completely by the slide behind at the moment.
Looks like the work of Destiny Hooker, who has had a fairly quiet role here so far in this match, but the Americans need her to become as prominent as Fabiana is. Get that arm, big right arm of hers swinging.
As the serving level needs to come up now for the USA.
Left alone, and good call. Probably doing Hooker a slight justice there. She does have 10 points and is the top American point scorer tonight, ahead of Aku Rindeo, who's a couple behind her, but this just doesn't seem to have played a prominent part in the match, but quietly going about her job, clearing the points. Aku Rindeo gets another point for the American cause. She started with sunglasses, didn't she? But has reverted to the clear spectacles here, as splitting those two players in the back row. And now Lindsay Berg, the captain. It's been a long time since the United States have been in front in this match. Set and a half. Shayla. Linz with the set.
Net touch against the USA, and they've recycled the ball as well. That'll hurt, that will. The fact that they've made the dig, and the net touch by Akin Rideo as she went up to block.
Nothing gets past the two referees, one upstairs and the other nearest the camera. Problems for America with that play, isn't it? They just don't have the answer at the moment.
Jackie comes in, just drifts past Logan Tom and hits inside Akin Rideo. Little change up with Tom playing as an opposite blocker, and it didn't work for them. It's changed now. I think the Brazil are definitely looking no more like the underdogs, no more like the team under pressure. They're looking like the favourites here.
Another unforced error there for the Americans, who've really just allowed the Brazilians to find their game, haven't they? Find their natural game. And now the Brazilians able to dictate the ebbs and flows of this match by the look of it. That's 4 points beyond halfway. Spike after spike hurting the Americans here now. 14-9.
USA's block has stopped functioning. Let's have a look at this. Hooker and Akinwido. Too much space between them. Hooker's gone too wide. And it doesn't matter then how high you go. If there's a gap for which the ball can fit through, Fegere is going to find it. That's better. Akinwido this time coming in through the middle and putting it away down to position five. Fabi tried hard, probably a little bit too far into court. Base position was should have been a bit wider. And this blocking substitution is there to add some extra height at the net now.
Yes, 1.93 meters. The veteran, Daniel Scott Doruda, 39 years of age. But a very astute customer, plenty of experience, which the Americans probably do with at the moment. Kept alive and got in the way of that, and so it's gone out of court. And when things aren't going well, they don't go right.
Oh, that was a shame. Tom had it covered. Nice pick up from Jackie. All out, hand under the ball. And then Akinwido playing in a position that normally would have seen Nicole Davis there, and didn't really know what to do, and he's taken it away from Logan Tom.
39-24. Brazil ahead on that count as well, and now ahead on the spikes. Hodge this time from the near side. 15-11.
At last we've been able to see what Hodge can actually do. Out wide, gap in the middle, and she has absolutely buried that one. And she's introduced herself to the game at last.
That's her first successful spike.
That was a wonderful play. There was the only option was Logan Tom. Everyone had gone in to help out on the block, and Nicole Davis had come in to play the ball, so that meant that Megan Hodge couldn't get out wide to go and have a hit. She's too far into court. Wonderful read by Logan Tom to see where the space was and get it away from Danny Linz.
And now Hanif Park, Deyiba Hanif Park, who's even taller than Scott Deruta, to 2.01 meters, 6'7", so there's some tall timber in that front court for the Americans now. Nice little run here from the United States, 3 points in a row. In fact, yes, it was 15-10, now it's 15-13.
Well, if there's anything that USA have on court now is plenty of experience. Scott Deruta and Hanif Park both played in 2008, both were starters. They know exactly what's required and how to deal with this situation. And maybe just that little bit of experience will help to settle down the USA over these next few points.
Off the block, get out, and that's a technical timeout two. We've hit 16. And the Brazilians take a 3-point lead into this pivotal point of this third set. They've been ahead from the start. They led all through that second set.
It does seem to have settled down somewhat now, despite the roller coaster of the first two sets. This one, and even with Brazil going ahead by some distance, USA have chipped away at it. They're back in touching distance, only 3 points separating them. It'd be a fascinating finish to this set.
So just the speed with which the match has been played, you wonder if this does go to four to five sets. It will certainly go Well, possibly it might go to four. Well, now, I suppose, might a minimum of four. If it goes to five after 15 days of the Olympic Games, you might wonder about whether fitness could play a part towards the end of this match. What's the call? It's out.
Hodges' time on court could be coming to an end if she continues to play like that. Larson may well have to come back in, and unless the reason Hodges on is because Larson is injured, but there was no sign of that. It just looked like it was not the kind of play that Yuma Kutchin was after from Larson, which is why Hodges in. But he won't be pleased with the way she's playing at the moment. That's a nice swing. First point for Danielle Scott-Aruda on the slide behind, and hardly any room to work with, but she gets it past Faye Garay. It's just those little things now that USA are starting to get right. They're starting to make the blocks, starting to put the ball away on their side out with consistency, and they're getting closer and closer to Brazil.
Figueroa absolutely unleashed everything into that, got the angle absolutely right, and not much Hodge could do about it. Just when the Americans look as if they might get onto an equal footing with Brazil, they move away again with this nice little three-point cushion here. Still on. Fabi off the block, and attempting the dig was Hodge, but it was always racing away from her. 19-15, things are looking very rosy all of a sudden for the Brazilians after that little run from the Americans.
It was a good effort from Hodge, but that was in a better dig from Danny Lins to set up the opportunity, and then an absolute belter from Jackie. All she wanted to do was put that ball away.
Is Kach Karai.
There's plenty of help, not just the coaching staff on the sideline. There are player coaching staff at the ends of court, plus also up in the crowd, constantly feeding information to Hugh McCutcheon. That's why he's got that earpiece in. He's being given information, the assistant coach is being given information, and then they're using that to decide exactly how Brazil are playing. What they're saying at the moment is that the ball's being cut away from the by the as hitter going cross court, something we can see obviously from watching the game, and that means they need to adjust their blocking slightly in order to combat it. Another slide behind from Scott Rudish. She's having a very good game since her introduction. Up until now, she's only ever come in to do blocking.
Too much power.
Danny Lin's having a very good game. She's recognised the fact that Jackie is playing exceptionally well, and so with every opportunity, unless there's the best place to go in the middle, then she's going wide to Jackie, and Shayla's not getting so much of the ball. This will suit Brazil just fine at the moment. They don't mind USA getting these side outs. That's hit the antenna as it goes off of Danny Lin, so immediately it's the USA point. Brazil are comfortable now in their own side out game.
Big point there for the Americans off their own serve, 20-18.
A very good set from Lindsay Berg. She was running forwards. Everyone thought it was going to go out to Logan Tom, and then she just set it back over her head for Hooker to put away off the block. And now the USA move into a strong position with Berg in the back row and three attacking options at the net. But they're still giving away too much cross-court to the outside hitters of Brazil. Figueiredo that time with a free hit cross-court. She's actually gone past the point in where the USA were blocking, so Hooker needs to come in about half a metre, start there, and then line up the middle blockers to take away the cross-court angle against what Brazil are trying to do to them through the outside.
Easily the closest of the three sets we've had so far. One set apiece. It's a tough time for Jose Guimaraes in his opposite number as well, McCutcheon. Not much they can do now. And the ball was in. That's the left arm of the first referee, Andrei Zinovich from Russia. Made it very clear that spike was good. Let's see what the television replay says. Yep, that's good. 22-19. Oh, gee, she didn't need to touch that. She went for the dig and gifted a point here at this vital moment of this set and the match, 23-19. It was sailing out, I think, wasn't it?
It looked to be going out. I can only imagine that she played that because she thought it was touched in the block. There's no other explanation for that. It was going clearly out.
Thank you, says Jose. 23-19. Brazil 2 points away from a 2-1 lead in this set. They're not home yet. Little unforced error from the serving line. Yes, could have done without that, says the coach. And McCutcheon making a substitution here.
Tamara Miyashiro coming in. Normally a libero, but being used so she can serve as well as playing across the back row.
And the crowd in a frenzy here at the moment, realising just how vital this next little passage is in the context of this match. Well, her serving skills rather deserted her there. I think you put the jinx on her, Clayton.
I think that's just the heat of the moment, but not staying focused on what's required. Massive situation, gold medal match, and you've just given set point to the opposition.
You'd think they'd have to take the second set from here, 24-20. Americans, first of all, want to side out. They haven't got it yet. Here comes Figueroa with a huge, big swing. And there it is. Shayla comes to the party right when they needed her. And the third set is in the bag, as they say, for Brazil. 25-20. Took 27 minutes. What a comeback. Dropped the first set, have won the next two, and in control of this match. Now one set away from the gold medal.
Stunning play by Brazil. They've you can forget all the pool play. You can forget anything that's happened to this point. You can forget that they got beaten by Korea 3-0. This is what they're here for. This is what counts. And they now have a 2-1 lead. For the United States, it's back to the wall. They have to win set four and then take it to a tiebreaker. It's as far as they've been pushed so far in the match, and at the moment Brazil have the upper hand. And you could see it every time there was an off-ball situation and it was an opportunity to have a swing. Brazil went up there and they absolutely belted the ball. Shayla started to get involved. Figueiredo was having a crack at the ball, and all of this has come from the leadership that Jackie has shown on court with the way that she's playing her volleyball in this match.
So the United States, I imagine, a little bit shell-shocked here, as we've mentioned. In the seven matches prior to this one, they had only dropped two sets. Now they've dropped two sets back-to-back in the one match. So a big test here, isn't it, for Hugh McCutchan now. How does he get them out of this hole that they've found themselves in or dug themselves into?
It's a real test of character for the USA as well, and the fact that they haven't really been pushed into this tournament, and now in the last match of the tournament they really are under the cosh.
Yes, in their two knockout matches they accounted for Korea 3-0 and the Dominican Republic 3-0. So they've come up against a team with a very different and far more aggressive and powerful attacking game, and just at the moment, despite some good defensive work in that first set, and the Brazilian attack seems to have the measure of them. So the experienced players and these two tall players from the bench, Scott Deruda and Hanif Park, 1.91 meter and 2.01 meters respectively, have been introduced to try and shore up that block, but not sure whether that's made much difference to the flow of this game.
For the USA, it's a question of getting back to basics. What did they do well in that first set? Why was it that they were able to do what they did to Brazil? Combination of things, Brazil slightly overawed by the situation, but secondly, the USA served extremely well, and they put Faye Garay, the front court swing hitter number 16, under immense pressure when she was front court, and they were getting then off-ball situations to deal with. They weren't having to deal with Thaisa and Fabiana coming through the middle and going on the slide behind, which they've now had to deal with in the last two sets.
So the pendulum is clearly here with Brazil at the moment, up by 2-1. The American captain will start this fourth set. We've been playing for an hour and 14 minutes.
Supreme confidence from Thaisa. She hammered that away, but a wonderful ball in from Brazil, and straight away the team are on a roll. They're full of confidence and they've instantly settled into this set.
I am surprised, Clayton, that we're not seeing the Americans coming through the middle tonight. It's been such a productive area for them, hasn't it, in some of their earlier matches, the one against Korea. I don't know whether it's because of the height of the of the Brazilian blockers, taller than the Korean blockers.
Well, a lot of it's to do with how good a ball in they were getting. In the first set, they were getting Lindsay Berg was getting a ball in she could operate with and use the middle. Not so much now. And then because it's not such a great ball in, she's not confident enough to go and set Akinridewu and to set Hamoto. And that's why it's playing into Brazil's hands at the moment.
Hodge just gets to that ball. And now something of a free ball here for the Brazilians. And too big. Tied up at 2-2. So at no stage of that second set or the third set were the Americans in front on the scoreboard. Must be wearing away at them as well. Just can't break out of the stranglehold that Brazil has managed to impose on them in this match. Akinridewu. Hodge. Here's the set from Linz, opposite number Berg, and Hodge again, but the American block may not be working as well as it would like, but certainly the Brazilian one is. And Hugh McCutchan, yes, pursing his lips and deep thought there. What's he got up his sleeve?
He's got the opportunity to bring Larsen back in if he needs to. Hodge started the set, but it was a clumsy hit from Hodge. She didn't take the block on. She didn't try and find an angle cross court.
And There was an attack through the middle, but the Brazilians have got everything covered at the moment.
Well, Scott Arruda was just a passenger in that rally, just watching Danny Lins, who's front court. She knows she's front court. She has to keep her hands up and focus in on every touch, and it was an easy put over for Lins. And, well, Scott Arruda was nowhere near it.
Just feels, doesn't it, like this Brazilian march is heading towards the top of the podium at the moment. They are just on top of their game. It's this instinctive element about their play. And the Americans are just struggling.
We're trying to get it all done in one swing. We're going to just have to manage things a little bit better. They're serving the crap out of it. Okay, I'm going to keep the ball off the net. Make sure that we're looking at the right things and that we're doing the right things. It's what we do every day. We just got to do it today.
Now some urgency in McCutcheon's voice, which we haven't seen much over the last couple of weeks when you're winning 7 matches out of 7. But now they are absolutely under the pump, aren't they? They know that. He knows that.
He's just starting to realise and starting to see how his team are reacting at the moment, and they're not playing smart volleyball like they have been. And that's why he's saying they're serving tough. Stop trying to put it on Lindsay Berg's head. Give it some room, give her some breathing space, allow her to come in and make sets. You still have options. Don't tuck her up at the net with the pass.
Hodge with just her third point of the match. Fourth set of the gold medal match here at Earls Court. Brazil ahead by 2 sets to 1. And the United States trailing 3-6 now. Figueroa. Just venting all of that nervous energy, patting the ball, going through that ritual as all players usually do on the service line. Good work from Hodge.
Well, the USA battling back. Hodge now will serve, and that means Logan Tom goes to the front row.
But all they seem able to do, Clayton, is battle to stay in contact with Brazil, don't they? They're not getting ahead of them. They're not being able to control these sets. And okay, this is as close as they've been for best part of 2.5 sets, 1 point behind in this crucial fourth set. And of course they've got to win this America or this match is all over.
Well, you can really see just how hard and how fast the ball is being hit when you're presented with that angle. From the side on, you lose some of that height and you lose some of the speed, but that was an excellent swing by Brazil. Figueroa putting it away.
Yes, hard to be too critical or critical at all of Harmoto there when that ball is coming at the speed that it did on the slow motion replay. You think, well, she's got plenty of time to get to the ball, but that's not real time. 7-5. Well, the Americans are fighting hard, which is what Hugh McCutcheon wanted them to do. Play by play, do what we're doing. What did he say? Do what we do and practice every day.
Hundreds of thousands of hours of training, and it all comes down to this. But despite all of that training, all of that effort, all of the years in the program, the one thing you can't train is this situation until you're actually in it. And then that's the only really time your coach is going to see how the players respond individually and as a team.
Yes, there's been a great debate going on here on local television here after the British relay team dropped the baton. And I heard an expert this morning, former Olympian, say you can train and train and train and practice as much as you like with your baton changing, but you can never, never produce a stadium with 80,000 people where you've got to hand the baton over at high speed. And it's the same here, isn't it? It's the same kind of environment that which the Brazilians really did seem unable to cope with in that first set. But they've settled down. They've found their rhythm and their timing. But it was remarkable the way they turned that first set around. You would have thought the demons would have been in their head for quite a while, but I can still remember that first point they scored in that second set. And it was just like the switch had suddenly been hit. And from that point on, they have not been behind. 2.5 sets, nearly. They've led the Americans. There they are, coming through the middle, the Americans that time, but to no avail. Everything they throw at them, the Brazilians have got the answer at the moment.
Well, there might be a career for Shayla on the beach with shots like that. She could see exactly what was going on. Everybody was in covering. Megan Hodge stuck in the middle, and it was a lovely cut shot to the line.
Nicely disguised there by Logan Tom. All that experience of hers from the previous Olympic Games. Yeah, she's one of these Americans who was on the losing side 4 years ago. She wouldn't want to experience that again, I imagine. Two silver medals. Silver and a gold, I think, would be a lot more attractive. Well picked up there by Hodge, and she comes over the top, but that was a poor little dink there. In.
The best the USA could do was to volley the ball over. They volleyed it at Danny Lins, who's the playmaker for Brazil, so that meant it had to go to a non-setter to put the ball up for someone to have a swing. But all credit to Figueres, she found an excellent angle cross court.
Well, there's one attack through the middle that worked for the United States. They still trail. Tom, pretty reliable with his serving. Shouldn't have said that. Sorry, Logan.
Well, looking around at the serving lineup for the USA, that they really are struggling at the moment. They haven't got anyone who you're thinking is going to go back and score a whole bunch of points for them.
And there's one more for Hodge off the Brazilian block. So edging to that second technical timeout of 16. And these are vital moments here for the Americans. They really want to try and, I think, at the very least, get onto some kind of parity with Brazil by the time that second technical timeout comes around. They're getting close. They can't get close, much closer than two. Occasionally they get to within 1 point. Brazil trying to side out here again. Hodge. It's a boot, the captain and setter. Oh, that was a poor attempt there by Hodge.
She's just getting some serving instructions from Guimarães.
Thirteen to nine. 4 points. How they'd like that sort of lead at the technical timeout.
It's just not happening for the USA. And the odd arm here, the odd shoulder there, and it's taking it away from another player who could have kept it in play.
Yes, it all looks a bit disheveled, doesn't it, for the American team at the moment. And Gomadas, a different man from the anxious fellow that he was on that first set. Shayla again. Picking up everything at the moment. They're just on such a big high. The Brazilians, everything is working for them.
Well, in most situations, the outside hitter with that off ball like that would have been thinking, spin it down to position one where the setter is. No, not Fegere. She's gone up and she has belted it cross court to the opposite corner. That is a magnificent hit in that situation.
Only 2 points away from a technical timeout, but McCutcheon can't wait. He's used his second and last timeout.
And that's where possibly people might argue, well, it's all very well for Hugh McCutcheon to keep it. Yeah, we got to work hard, and if we side out, there's a lot more points left in the game. But what he hasn't told them is he hasn't given them any information there to tell them how to deal with what Brazil are currently doing to them.
The top of the fingertips, so 14-10. But to now, these are the vital rallies for the United States, the ones that they're serving. Destiné Hooker. Too quick, isn't it? Just blasting through the American block. And he's got his charges playing just like he wants them to.
Fegere's become a revelation in this tournament. It was number four Paola who started the Olympic Games, the player who started in the final in 2008, but has been relegated to the bench in favour of Fegere, who came on as a sub and has kept her place, and you can see exactly why. She is playing magnificently as a swing hitter.
The further this match goes, the wider the gap there is between these two teams, just in the performance on court, and starting to be reflected in the score as well. 16-10, we've arrived at the technical timeout.
Yeah, could do that. But we lost Courtney's serve. Yeah, I know. But we got a good serve from D. It is what it is, but we didn't get the block. Again. All right, Joe Nellis on that. All three.
Interesting. Coach's conflap about what's happening and why it's happening. Hugh McCutcheon obviously accepts the fact that Destiné Hooker's serve is what it is. She's a raw athlete. They don't want to take her out if they can help it, because they take her out from the serve, they lose her on the backcourt pipe or on the backcourt 10, which is the hit from position one, but it's called a 10 because it's in the back row. And so they're really just trying to come up with something at the moment that they can do to turn their fortunes around.
Yeah, just to break the stranglehold, isn't it? Because you can almost sense here the Brazilians are just choking the Americans, aren't they? Choking the life out of them. Choking the life out of their attack. And finding plenty of holes in their block as well. Fegere, 11 points tonight. Shayla, leading point scorer with 14. Fegere, second. One point for the Americans, but they need a lot more than that.
So the decision's been taken by the USA. Hodge off, Larson on, and she gets that wipe off and then gets a chance to serve. And Larson's been a mainstay throughout the tournament. She's been the first six outside hitter along with Logan Tom. It's only been this match, really, we've seen that decision to have Hodge come in.
Well, you talked to Clayton about the serving problems that the American coaches had, and I noticed that there isn't one American in the top 10 servers from the tournament. Shayla, the Brazilian, is the top server, but not one American in the top 10, and yet here they are in the final.
Interesting substitution. Natalia coming in for Fabiana, not only to be able to serve and play defense, but as an extra weapon in the back row so she can hit from the pipe or from the 10 position. Well, it's going from bad to worse for the USA. The ball into the antenna.
Mm. Yep, that's out. And you might come to the conclusion now that the writing is just about on the wall from the Americans. This would be a major turnaround if they can get themselves out of this 11-18. Make that 19-11. Just this instinctive nature of the Brazilians. It's magical, isn't it?
Very, very brave and wise play from Dani Linz to go over onto USA. We're not expecting that. Harmoto's hands are down. She's having to reach across. Lack of discipline from the USA, fully exploited by Brazil.
Well, it's probably not a bad time to make a poor serve when you're ahead by eight with the gold medal only 6 points away. No, the Americans, they just got to get a surge going here quickly. If they don't get it in the next few rallies, the match is basically gone. Even now, you'd think the Brazilians can happily just side out here, take this third set.
Well, that looked close to being in, actually. Yeah, first glance, I thought Tyser had made the baseline.
Yes, I think he feels the same. It's not the critical point anyway at this juncture, is her motto. Better work.
Well, we've very interesting twice now. Slide behind for Tyser. One unforced error, one block. That's why she's much better hitting in front and usually does.
They've been playing so well, the Brazilians, that Gomardus hasn't needed a timeout now. The technical timeouts and the American timeouts have been enough, but he has another one up his sleeve. So if the Americans start to get a run going here, bingo. He'll stop that mid-flight.
Blocking substitution for the USA. Lindsay Berg off. And Hanif Park is on.
Back with the Krista Harmoto. Seems a long way back, isn't it? The Americans are having to come from here, 14-19. Confusion reigns between the blockers. And that's important point in this set and the match now for Brazil, 20-14. They can taste that 25th point now, I think.
It's like watching Brazil in the first set. Unforced error twice now. They've hit the antenna.
Yep, right in front of the first referee. Point goes, of course, therefore, to Brazil. Now just 4 points away. Tom, no way through the block. 22-14. Boy, this is going to be some party, isn't it? In a few minutes, you'd think right now.
Well, Earl's Court absolutely erupted when that ball went down. USA have just stopped playing.
Yeah, we're just counting down the clock here in a sense, aren't we? I think the Americans know that. They are a beaten team. And they must be bewildered. How did this happen? How did it go from such a high at the end of the first set to this dismal place they find themselves in now?
Great serving from Brazil, and the USA's serve-receive unit hasn't functioned. The middle's not been allowed to run, and Brazil have picked everything up that's come at them. And when they haven't, someone's still got a touch on it. There's been so few clean winners for the USA in the last couple of sets.
Not much talking going on in that American team anymore. A few brave American fans wave their flag in the hope that it might just lift the spirits of these women to see if they can get across the line in this set. But it's a huge mountain to climb from here. 16-23. Here's a chance for Brazil to side out here to get it to gold medal point, as they call it. Oh, they might be just getting a wee bit ahead of themselves, the Brazilians as well. Just taking their foot off the pedal a bit here, as it were. 23-17. Still pretty comfortable and pretty safe, you would think, for the these South American magicians. Just played this wonderful brand of volleyball for the last three sets, and that's in. Here we are. Gold medal point for the South Americans. The defending champions ready to claim the gold medal once again. Here's the set. Here's the spike. Off the block. 4 more years. Olympic champions for 4 more years, Brazil. Beijing in 2008. They come to London and they will leave the British capital once again as the Olympic champions.
What a marvellous turnaround. Start of this game, everyone would have been saying the USA. I thought it was going to be the USA the way they were playing. In the first set, after they absolutely thumped Brazil, it was definitely going to be USA's match. And then Brazil picked themselves up, they dusted themselves down, they came out and they stopped the USA from playing, and they thoroughly deserved to have taken the gold medal.
A barely comprehensible transformation after that first set. They looked down and out, this team. They looked beaten physically and psychologically by the Americans, who just ripped through them in that first set. But right from the start of the second set, it was a different team that took the court. Might have been in the same strip, but there were different players. And from that point on, the United States never again got themselves ahead on the score in any set. For the next three sets, they were dominated by this Brazilian team. 25-17, 25-20 and 25-17. 1 hour and 40 minutes to claim the gold medal at the London Olympics.
Well, Hugh McCutcheon and his team probably just can't believe what's happened and the manner in which it's happened. They feel they've been robbed.
Their only defeat coming in their eighth and final match here at Earl's Court.
And it just goes to show, you just can't predict what's going to happen. And the fact that they come into this, the fact they'd already beaten Brazil 3-1 in the pool matches. They'd only dropped two sets before the start of this gold medal match, and then they have been turned over by Brazil. And I think as well, you have to give complete credit to Jackie, who, number eight, who after that first set just went out and said, right, girls, this is how we play. And she battered the ball and battered the ball. She played great defense. She put a great ball in. And that's what it means. Fabi, it's, well, the emotions come flooding out now.
I'm not sure, Clayton, whether there would be too many of many other teams that could have turned it around, because they just dug into their soul, did they? And then there's something in that spirit of Brazilians, in that emotional, instinctive way they react, and they just went out there. And I guess most other teams would be carrying the baggage of that loss in the first set, deep into the second set maybe, but not this team. It was like they just started the match afresh at the beginning of the second set, and then it just won it 3-0.
That's exactly right. Pick yourselves up. Right, how about we go again? This is the first set, so we've had a little warm-up. Let's go and play. And they went out and played.
Now a little private moment that is very universal and very public. All the support team there as well. I think there might be a party back in the Brazilian quarters in the village tonight.
It could be into the small hours.
A few members of this team now with two gold medals from the Olympic Games. Another Cuban team won the three in a row, didn't they? Back in the 70s or 80s, the Cuban women. And now the other significant thing here for the Brazilian team, of course, is they will be defending their title at home in 4 years. Imagine how big a deal that will be, and how difficult it's going to be for any other country in the world to get past this team now. You imagine their focus for the next 4 years will be to do this in front of their own fans in Rio. And boy, what a date that will be with destiny.
I think for some of the players, they will be there as well, but it might well be the end of the road for Paola, number four. She was reduced to a bit part here in this final. She was a starter in 2008. Vegares quite comfortably taken her place. And when you start to build now off the back of these Olympics, and especially as it's going to be a home Olympics, and they'll want to defend that title, make it three in a row, we could see a fair amount of these players not making that final team, Ferdaninha being one of them, number nine. So expect to see changes, but I think we can see quite a few of those players still involved come the Olympics in 2016.
Where I imagine after this performance tonight, they will start as the favourites. I'm sure if I walked into a bookie shop here in London and asked what odds you're going to give me on Brazil to win the women's gold medal in 4 years, they wouldn't be great. But at the moment, they're not thinking of Rio. They're just thinking of what they've done over the last hour and 40 minutes. Such a stylish and elegant team of women, aren't they? They're just such a credit to their country, such a credit to their sport. And there is the story. The Americans, who had only dropped two sets in seven matches prior to this final, won that first set, and I remember saying, so they've now won four of the last five sets against Brazil here, because they did beat them. The United States beat Brazil in pool play, and then lost the next three. Some highlights. That's the gold medal point. Don't think it's sunk in at that point. Just a kind of sense of relief and a bit of joy starting to course through the veins.
And your heart goes out to the USA as well after they played so well. You just wonder, though, the fact that they coasted through to this final almost unopposed, and they breezed past Brazil once already, whether or not that was there in the forefront of their minds that actually this should be a bit of a stroll in the park. And despite what the coaches, and no doubt Hugh McCutcheon would have been saying to them, do not think for 1 minute this is going to be easy. And especially then after the first set, and then when they did get put under pressure, they just struggled to deal with it, couldn't react to it.
So Fabi saying it's two and one more. We want one more. Yeah, you are number one, no question about that at all. And Taisa there, who, remember back at the midway through that first set, toward one of the timeouts in that first set where Gomara's said to her, you know, let her know in no uncertain terms what she was doing wrong and what she had to address. And then she did. She went out from that point, and every one of them in the team just lifted their game immeasurably from the end of that first set.
Don't think it's quite sunk in for some of the American players, the shock of the situation, having not done it. The fans delighted. A magnificent game of volleyball and befitting of a final. I guess for the neutrals, we would have liked to have seen the USA take that fourth one and then exactly. Send it into the real drama of a fifth, but Brazil were not going to let that happen.
A little message to all the folks back home. Maybe a little word to mum and dad. Papa, papa.
I've never seen them do that before, I must admit. I've seen them win a few titles and not seen them get involved in roly-polies.
A little bit of gymnastics to warm down, the old forward roll. So there's the stats from the last set. Again, the Americans just completely blown away there. 9 spikes from 33 attempts, couple of blocks. Their digs only not even 50%. And Brazil 17-3-16, well ahead. And I imagine that'll be mirrored in the statistics from the whole match as well. Look at those digs, 63 versus 37. 9 service errors from the Americans and a couple of aces going each way, but it's the top numbers that count. 3 sets to Brazil, 1 to the United States. Repeat scoreline also from what happened 4 years ago when Beijing went much the same way. They shared the first 2 sets and then Brazil won the next 2. So there's the official ranking here from the Olympic Games in London in 2012. Brazil, the United States and Japan, who will take home the medals. Korea beaten today by Japan for the bronze medal, and China and the Dominican Republic ranked 5th equal. Well, along with Italy and Russia, all of the teams that made the quarterfinals and the 4 that missed out, Great Britain and Turkey, followed by Algeria and Serbia. So no elimination matches as such, or classification matches as such?
No, it just depends that if you finish bottom of your group, which Algeria and Serbia did, so they became joint 11th, and Great Britain and Turkey were fifth in their group, so they were joint 9th as a result.
And I imagine those rankings will also impart on the new world rankings when they come out.
It'll make a big difference. You have a look at the highlights from the match. I mean, just spectacular. But I think more than anything, it's just the way that Brazil came out after that thumping. They were given a complete lesson in volleyball in the first set, but they didn't say, but they took the lesson. They said, thank you very much. Okay, we've learned from that, come out and play. And then when they went to the USA and said, right, here's a lesson for you, the USA couldn't respond.
Logan Tom, knowing she's going to have to settle for her 2nd silver medal from her appearances at the Olympic Games, and Fabiana, who had a fabulous game, and the diving, despairing attempt by Megan Hodge to get to the ball, and Hugh McCutcheon, nothing he could do in the end.
Well, you did say towards the end of this tournament, if Hugh McCutcheon won, he'd achieved everything. What's he going to do now? Well, I think he'll probably stay with the women's program and see if he can actually get the gold.
Yes, a real sense of unfinished business, which he might be able to address 4 years' time in Rio. Not a bad record he's got, is it, from 2 visits to the Olympic Games, a gold and a silver. But I guess one area that the Americans might want to work on is their serving, isn't it?
They just need somebody in there, and a lot of float serving, a lot of tactical serving they employed in the first set, which worked well. But then as soon as Brazil made adjustments, they took Faye Garay out of the pass, effectively. so she wasn't being exposed, and then that gave Brazil options. And there just isn't somebody who can go in and really deliver a tough, hard serve. I think across the board, they need to up their serving game, get the tempo right. Destiny Hooker's only going to get better and better. And I think when she develops her serve, that's going to be a real power. And maybe they'll do something there. But yeah, it was just the one area where they lacked in this match.
So we assume that we will have the victory ceremony coming shortly. And a big crowd here waiting for this, particularly the Brazilian fans.
Yeah, they'll take the court away so the net and post will come down so that the podium can go up, which obviously with the beach, with the volleyball, it's a pretty big podium. You've got to get all the squad on and it stretches right away across the court.
And there is the podium and the national colours of the Olympic Games being constructed there for the three team big podium, because there's going to be the best part of 36 players on the podium. Everyone in the squad gets a medal, not just those that took part in the match today.
Well, the next test for us actually, Brendan, is because obviously we've spent 2 weeks watching them play in their uniforms with their hair tied back. And then they come out with their hair down and the makeup on, and it really becomes an identity parade.
Yes. Yeah.
But it's fascinating to have watched these games and see how the teams have played, and been some real surprise stories. I think Korea, with their victory, a surprise victory over Brazil, and they can walk away from these games, even though they finished fourth and they haven't taken away a medal, they'll be able to say, yeah, well, we beat the Olympic champions. Japan, what a success story for them, taking the bronze medal and achieving something that hasn't been achieved in just short of 30 years for their national side, to have a medal at the Olympic Games. And for the likes of Takeshita and Yuko Sano, it's probably going to be their last games, and to have walked away and have achieved an Olympic medal in their career as volleyball players will be something special for them. And we saw in that bronze medal match the tears of joy for both of them as they realized what they'd achieved. It's heartache for the USA, but they've come here. They were the favourites. They will look at this and think, OK, well, we didn't play as well as we should have done. Take nothing away from Brazil. Thoroughly deserved their gold medal. And the USA have come here. They've done it. They've got into themselves into their second successive final. It's a silver medal, but it's a medal and they've achieved. Whether they feel they've given it their all, well, that's, I'm sure some of the players will think they have. Some probably haven't. But again, it's just the drama of volleyball, the excitement. It'll be interesting to see what the teams do now off the back of this Olympic cycle, and they start building for Rio in 2016. Who's going to make the cut? Who will stay with the team maybe for another year or so to help bed in the new players that will come in, the youngsters, and who will just hang up their knee pads off the back of this event?
Well, when you look at their history at the Olympic Games over the last 20 years or so, they must have some very good development programs in place in Brazil, because they've never finished worse than fourth from the last six Olympic Games. One this year, one first 4 years ago, fourth, third, third and fourth. So right back to 1992, 20 years, they've never finished worse than fourth. So something must be working in their systems in Brazil, and you'd imagine they will be pumping even more energy and more resources into the next 4 years.
I would say it's brutal, but it's a brutal regime, because it's such a popular sport in Brazil outside of football, and it's right up there with football in terms of popularity, the number of people that play it. When they have a tryout for the national team, for the squads, literally they'll have 100, maybe 200 people there. They'll take them around an athletics track, and the first few hours is run around the track. And it's nothing to do with their volleyball ability, it's to do with their physical fitness, the first test, and then they'll cut half of them straight away, because they're not fit enough. So it's so intense, and the players are so good, and they have to be, because for some of them it's a massive life-changing opportunity to make it through to the national team to play volleyball and earn a living from it. The leagues in Brazil, very strong, the professional leagues as well, the top division, and it's good enough that the top players stay and play in Brazil. We don't see them going to Italy, which is considered to be one of the top domestic leagues in Europe, if not the world. And Brazil tend to keep their players there. China and Japan keep their players in their respective countries. Japan have a very good Premier League, which is based around the corporations. So a lot of teams are associated to companies and are sponsored by those companies. So they're effectively employees of those companies and effectively have a job for life, but their job is to play volleyball. And that's why they stay in their country. So it's all to do with the popularity, the fact that so many people play it and it's a good level. And of course, with the beach volleyball as well, and the success that Brazil have had over the years, that I think it's just going to get better and better for them, and I wouldn't be surprised if we see them again in the final come 2016.
Well, we're going to see them in the final, aren't we, tomorrow night in the men's as well. So this could be probably the most memorable weekend in Olympic history for Brazil. The men have won the gold medal a couple of times over the last 20 years. And I imagine they're going to be absolutely motivated even more so after what they've seen from their girls tonight here at Earl's Court. And the men will be here on this very court in just under 24 hours to try and do the same. And we'll have a formidable opponent in the form of Russia. So that should be a match worth waiting for, a mouth-watering prospect, Brazil and Russia. But the Brazilian women have done a bit, I'm sure, to psych up the men for their big clash.
Well, no doubt
tomorrow.
We'll see them here. I think I had a look over at the beach volleyball at Horse Guards Parade, and when Germany were playing Brazil, and it was one game. It was Brink and Reckerman against Alison and Emmanuel. Alison and Emmanuel were everybody's favourites to win. They got to the final. They're the current world champions, and they're up against the world champions of 2009 in Brink and Reckerman. But Germany indoor team who've been playing here, Stervold and Max Gunthor and Grozer and Tischer and Bjorn Andre, I mean, all the boys were there supporting it their utmost. There was a fans there with all the rest of them supporting Germany, and Germany went on to win the match. So I wouldn't be surprised if we see if not all of the Brazilian girls here for that gold medal match, just to spur on their teammates.
Just waiting for the appearance of the three teams. Japan, who will collect the bronze medal, of course. And the two teams that contested that final, the United States with another silver medal and Brazil with another gold medal. The other thing is, Clayton, I noticed going into this tournament here, the United States were ranked one and Brazil were ranked two. You'd think that would change, wouldn't it?
It should do. Depends, I think, off the back of this. They certainly are
the
number one team.
Hard to see how the United States could retain their number one ranking if they don't win the gold medal here at the Olympic Games.
I think from that point of view, I suppose, effectively what it does mean is it whether USA are one and Brazil stay two, because they are one and two, if it swaps, it just means they still stay at the other end of the seedings from each other anyway and wouldn't generally meet until this stage of the competition anyway. It'd be interesting to see what those rankings are, and you know, for Japan, how far have they moved up, and Korea even, who I think were 13th coming into this. They've now finished fourth at the games. How far that will propel them up the rankings.
It is one of the frustrations with the medal ceremonies for team events, this wait from the end of the match until the medals come out. If it's a track and field or swimming or cycling, there is plenty of other events going on in between.
Well, there's a couple of factors to take into account. Japan have already been watching this game. Their bronze medal match happened a little earlier today.
Yeah.
But the two teams have just played. They have to go off, and for the USA, they've got to really recompose themselves now. They go off and they'll have a sit and a chat, and they'll change their uniforms. It may even be enough time for both teams to go off quickly, have a shower, get changed, and come back for the medal ceremony.
Yeah, so, but I'm thinking, here's a stadium full of people, thousands and thousands of people. Maybe they need to revise some of these methods of doing this. Would it be such a terrible thing if they just had the ceremony shortly after the end of the match, while everyone's on a high?
Absolutely. It takes, as we've seen, it takes a couple of minutes to take the net down and to put that podium up. And in fact, I was here at the test event down announcing and went through this whole business. So I've actually sat there and done this and brought the teams on and announced them all. And it did actually go a little bit quicker than this. But I guess there's always some last minute hitches. And when it comes down to it, just making sure it runs smoothly. And I think the biggest problem they've got at the moment is actually getting USA and Brazil out and getting them ready. They'll come out from the tunnels and be introduced. So it's just finding that. And they're trying to go as quickly as they can. I know a lot of colleagues and friends of mine and family have gone to watch this as well and here in the audience. And they've all said, oh, yeah, going to stay for the medal ceremony, going to stay for the medal ceremony. It's a big part of coming to watch a gold medal match, to actually stay and see the medals be presented.
And the worldwide television audience as well, although I guess if people aren't seeing anything on their television screen and time ticks by, they lose a lot of people. So there is issues here, which particularly for team sports, I've seen this at quite a few events. It's never an issue at the main stadium from track and field or swimming, because there's one race finishes, the next race started, then when the competitors or the medalists are ready, bring them out, we'll have the victory ceremony. That you don't hold up the entire proceedings waiting for one ceremony.
I guess for the Brazilian fans, they are loving every minute of this and savouring the whole atmosphere. The press are all ready, they're all down there ready to go, and the bulbs will be flashing away, no doubt, as soon as they're introduced. We'll see the teams come out, they'll come up and they'll get their medals and get their flowers, and then the seen in the past as well, no doubt there might be some ticker tape sprayed around the place when the Brazilians take to the top of the podium. Fascinating 2 weeks of women's volleyball, with the men to come tomorrow. And as you say, Brendan, chance for Brazil to do the double. They had to set it for gold and silver last time out.
Well, they haven't had a great day today because there was a big upset in the football. Brazil were beaten by Mexico in the men's final of the football, and a lot of our colleagues from South America here, from including many from Mexico, were delirious with that result. Anyone that ever beats Brazil in football, that in itself is cause for national celebration. To do it in the final at the Olympic Games is a truly great occasion. So again, the Brazilian women here have given the folks back home something to really celebrate after the disappointment of earlier in the day.
And it's been a fascinating games. It's one in which it will live long in the memory, that's for sure. And I certainly I think as well, from the athletes' point of view, not just the athletes who are here to play volleyball, but right across the spectrum of all the sports at the games, the athletes' village over the years seems to have been getting closer and closer to the Olympic parks and so on. And here it's literally a 5 minute walk from the athletes' village to the main stadium, to the Olympic Park, where the majority of the events are taking place. And not only that, based in Stratford, there's a huge shopping mall that has also meant the athletes have been coming out on a regular basis, wandering around the shopping mall, and this whole buzz that's been going around the capital city, because people who haven't had tickets to the venue, haven't been able to actually go and see it, have been able to come to the shopping mall. You can see the venue as well, you can see the Olympic Stadium from there, wandering around, mixing with the athletes. It's been a really great atmosphere at these games, and certainly in terms of how it's been received. I know, obviously, in the build-up to this in the UK, there was a lot of consternation. Are we, you know, is it going to be a success? Are we going to be able to achieve what we need to? But so far, so good as far as the games are concerned, and the way it's happened, and obviously for Great Britain themselves, the Team GB doing well across the board, and keeping the and delighting the home fans. And it's amazing as well when you have your home games, and as Brazil are no doubt going to find out when they go and to look to defend their title in 2016, just the buzz of having so many fans there cheering you on can, in volleyball, act as the seventh man for the team, or the eighth man. Obviously now we have the libero, but can really spur you on to achieve things. And I think that was in evidence here for this game as well. There were so many Brazilian fans here that were shouting them on, and you will have noticed that when USA was serving, there was a bit of a boo going around, and the trying to create this home atmosphere for Brazil in the final. And it seems to have paid off in the way that they're able to go about their business in set 2, 3 and 4 and just totally dominate it and not let, as you pointed out, Brendan, they didn't let the USA get the lead in those last three sets.
The other issue which possibly is playing out here is the press conferences which are going on, and just got a few quotes here from the leading participants, and Hugh McCutcheon, the USA coach, has said about Brazil, he was very forthcoming, very gracious. They started serving much more aggressively, in all honesty, said McCutcheon, they were better than us. They were passing us and we didn't really respond as well as we should have done. But he said, I'm very proud of my team. We didn't get the result we wanted, but it's the way it goes. That's life. Kudos to Brazil, but I'm still proud of my team. You can't always get the gold, but you have to look at what you do and try and achieve it. And we tried our best. That was Hugh McCutcheon just a few moments ago. His opposite number. Well, I think we're getting some activity down there on the floor.
The victory ceremony for women's volleyball.
And yet, it has taken 2 weeks and 38 matches, but it's time for the medals to be presented here. The victory ceremony for the women's volleyball here at Earls Court. The United States, Japan, and of course, the gold medal winners, Brazil. Brazilian team, they're in a party mood, all right. Probably not their preferred kind of music, but they'll dance to anything right now. Contrast that with the very formal approach taken by the Americans and the Japanese here. In the press conference afterwards, Jose Guimarães, the Brazilian coach, just talked about what a wonderful feeling it is. Absolutely amazing. Last year we lost every match against the United States, but for me, the United States were the favorites before this match, and we played very well tactically. Three different dignitaries will present the medals, members of the IOC and former sports people, and the IOC vice president there as well.
Yumilka Ruiz will be delighted to be part of that, former Cuban international player and medalist. Also down there, Mr. Ji Zhongwei, the FIVB president, will be handing out the medals. And us in the crowd all being introduced to them.
And Mr. Ji Zhongwei, rep-
representing the International Volleyball Federation.
He's done a sterling job, actually, for the FIVB since he took over a few years ago. He's not going to stand for re-election, so there will be a new president of the FIVB at the next set of elections they have.
First to receive their medals are the Japanese team, who earlier this day defeated their Korean rivals and claimed the bronze medal. First time since 1984 that Japan have won a medal at the Olympic Games.
So it's the captain, Erika Arakai, gets the medal first. Next to her, Yamaguchi, the backup setter who came on and did her job. And for me, the greatest setter that's ever played the game, in Yoshi Takeshita.
Japan, who won the very first gold medal in women's volleyball at the Olympic Games in 1964, completely dominated the sport internationally for the next 12 years, won the gold medal twice in 64, 1976, and a couple of silver medals in between at Munich in 1972 and Mexico City in 1968. Then the bronze medal in 1984, and this is their first appearance on the victory dais since 1984.
What a marvellous games Yuko Sano's had defensively, one of the best liberos. Ai Otomo, who played extremely well in the middle for Japan throughout the tournament. Nishinabe, who came in, number 12, she came in. She wasn't the starting player, but did her job extremely well. And Sakoda, well, number 14, she's the girl who hit the winning point for Japan to get their bronze medal. Ibata, who had an indifferent tournament. She started, but then was reduced to the bench. And it was Kimura who led the line for Japan in the opposite slot.
Posy of flowers, by the look of it, to be given, I imagine, to each of the players.
I think Japan very worthy of their bronze medal. They thoroughly entertained with every time they stepped onto the court and played their very unique brand of volleyball. Very fast, very quick, lots of movement around the setter, Takeshita, and also knowing and playing to their strengths and trying to deal with their weaknesses. Oh dear, they dropped the posy, but they won't mind that, they've got the medals. The fact that they were able to move Takeshita around as well and not have her exposed all the time, blocking on that right-hand side of court. Sometimes she would block through the middle, sometimes she would just step off the net altogether and allow Otomo Ai to come in, or Erika Arakai to come in and block in her position. So very deceptive play, and always thinking, and superb defense as well. Really had the crowd on the edge of their seats and screaming and shouting and getting thoroughly involved in the wonderful style of volleyball that Japan play.
Yeah, I picked the setter in the lineup.
Just want to have a little chat with the players and congratulate them.
Now a bittersweet moment, I imagine, for the American team. I think from memory 309 gold medals that you can win at these Olympic Games. So presumably there's 309 silver medals. There's about 15,000 competitors here, so only a tiny small percentage of athletes go home with a medal. But as I said, for the Americans, it's probably a bittersweet. They started maybe as the favourites. They'd been the most impressive team here this week and last week. And they won the silver medal 4 years ago, but still unable to, as they say, bring home the cigar.
Nice little moment between Jamilka and Scott Arruda and Hanif Park. They would have played against each other when they first started out in their careers, and USA had plenty of close matches with Cuba. As a player who probably didn't perform at her absolute best today. Megan Hodge did all she could do when she came onto court. Krista Hamato was included in the team ahead of Heather Bowne, who had been a mainstay for the USA right up to this Olympic Games. I think Hamato did an excellent job in that position. And Logan Thomas, ever always reliable as an outside hitter, but serving just let herself down a little bit today. But overall, you can't take it away from the USA. They played superbly well. It just wasn't quite good enough on the day.
There was Faluki out to the left there. Akunwadewa getting her medal, the top blocker at the Olympic Games, but didn't see much of that today, did we, from her?
Once Brazil's got that serve going and put them under pressure, they were chasing shadows.
United States have been at the Olympic Games every year since it was first introduced in 1964, and twice, now three times after tonight, have been runners-up. Three silver medals, 1984, 2008, and now 2012. Also won the bronze medal at Barcelona in 1992. But still can't get their hands on that elusive gold medal, and it'll be probably even tougher to do that, I imagine, in 4 years' time in Rio. A muted sense of joy there coming, understandably, from the American team, who've brought a lot of pleasure to hundreds of thousands of people and millions worldwide with their play over the last 2 weeks. But there can only be one winner. The best of the best.
Well, you can run out of superlatives, can't you? It was just the manner of their victory. And look at that, Fabi again, just about to break down. She's got a gold medal, and the tears are almost starting for her.
Yeah, they have, well and truly.
Mario Pesanti, who's presenting these medals, has gone on record as saying how delighted he's been with the crowds here at Earls Court, the fact that it's been packed for nearly every single game, and the way that it's been embraced in the UK. Appreciating the fact that it's a minority sport in the UK, and he thought that it might not be so well received, but he's been absolutely delighted with it, and said it's been an absolute success from that point of view. And I think we've seen that here, the way the volleyball's been played, the fact that it's been capacity crowds and everyone so enthusiastic, not about necessarily the teams, but the level of play and what they've witnessed.
Well, that's right, Clayton. You and I obviously come from English-speaking countries, and you're right, in most English-speaking countries, probably outside of the United States, the sport is minor. But I must say, just wearing a television commentator's hat at the Olympic Games, I've been to the last nine Olympics. I remember commentating volleyball at the 1976 Olympics in Montreal, And I always have this job to explain to people in my part of the world afterwards just how big volleyball is at the Olympic Games. In a lot of English-speaking countries, now that's not obvious. But when you are here at the Olympics and you look, just look at this venue, probably is the biggest indoor venue in Britain, I imagine, Earl's Court. I don't know whether there'd be too many other indoor venues that could hold much more than 15,000 people or 15,000 seats. And as you say, it's full every day in a country where volleyball has a fairly low profile. But it does have this legacy. It has an Olympic legacy, which puts it up there with all of the major sports at the Olympic Games. And these folk here, probably most of the audience here, are Brits or English people. And once you've come to a game of volleyball at the Olympic Games, you always come back for more.
Ji Zhongwei, the FIVB president, handing out the flowers, the posies for the players. A charming man is Mr. Ji Zhongwei. Always got a smile on his face, always happy, always pleased to see, always got time for people as well when he's at events to have a chat with them and talk volleyball.
Well, I've been reading here in the local newspapers about the rewards that countries are giving their sportsmen and women who win gold medals. In some countries, it's in excess of $100,000. In others, it's considerably less than that. So I'd imagine these young women will be getting a little bonus from their government or their national sports federations when they get home. It seems to be the case for most, if not all, countries here, big or small. I think the Americans, surprisingly enough, were only likely to receive something like $30,000 US. I say only $30,000, but compared to some other countries, it was a relatively small amount. And they'll be getting something, obviously, also for winning a silver medal. But money not really the issue at all for anyone that comes to the Olympic Games. It's about that piece of metal you've got around your neck. And there's no monetary value that you can place on that. So there they are. They will take to the court in Rio de Janeiro in 4 years' time, still as the Olympic champions in women's volleyball. And now we stand for the national anthem. That is a truly beautiful piece of music, isn't it? Rather reminds me of a Joseph Haydn symphony. And not a dry eye in the house, or the commentary box, I imagine, for that matter, at the moment either. And easy to understand how emotional these wonderful women from Brazil must be feeling at the moment after this ceremony.
The only time we've seen them running in slow motion.
I always think this must be one of the loveliest times when you've won a gold medal. You've all the emotion has come out, you've been through the ritual, you've got your medal, It's all over. You can start to relax, and from now on, it must be just overwhelmed with enjoyment, with a sense of joy. And there's Fabi. She'd been in tears basically since that final point. But even she's now in a position to really enjoy the fruits of her labour for the last 2 weeks. And there we are. We may not be at the main stadium, but they all want Brazilian flags. They want to do the lap of honour and just thank their fans who contributed mightily to this wonderful atmosphere here at Earl's Court. Very much a case of girls' court tonight, wasn't it? As the Americans make their way off with dignity.
So there's just some commemorative t-shirt. These are for the guys that were in the squad but didn't make it through to the games. Jusili, Sasha, Fabiola and Brait, all part of this team that got them to this point but didn't make the final selection. And that's really nice to see, the recognition from their teammates of their contribution in order to help them get to the games and ultimately get the gold medal.
So the full family of support for the women's team from Brazil are there enjoying the moment as well. And that's a fitting image to end this wonderful day here at Earl's Court. And we leave you with the memories of the best women's volleyball team in the world. They proved that 4 years ago, and they confirmed it again here today at Earl's Court with a, in the end, emphatic victory over the United States by 3-1 to take the gold medal, and Japan earlier in the day taking the bronze medal. But the world of volleyball right now salutes Brazil. Yeah.
Hello and welcome to